So it's time to invite Denmark again, and Thomas Sinkjæer, Senior Vice President for the Lundbeck Foundation. But I have understood that it was in the Willem Foundation that you made some interesting work that started this, that you're going to talk about, and now you could continue it in the Lundbeck Foundation. So you're warmly welcome. I hope your microphone works. Have you?
Okay.
First of all, thank you so much for inviting me, particularly to Christina Moberg, and also for setting this exciting meeting up. I think we have learned a lot. I could actually end my talk just by saying, if everybody listened to what Wilhelm Krutz said, I don't have to repeat it, what he said, because I'm going to repeat more or less word by word what he was saying in a little different way. And therefore, we can so my core message to you today is, I think we're all in this room in favor of using peer review, but I'm not sure we're all aware of the limitation it has. And I think this was some of the things that Wilhelm was hinting to. And what I would like to do is I would actually like to go a little deeper in that, on that issue, and then discuss on how can we then counteract that. But just before I come to that, I don't know. These are not mine.
This is not your presentation.
It's going to be difficult for me to.
Now it's on.
Okay.
Now it should be.
Then I'm more happy.
Sorry.
Before we come to that part, I will say a little bit about how private foundations in Denmark contribute to public research, and then a little bit of us, and then come back to what I think is the more exciting part of this presentation. In Denmark, we are in this fortunate situation that private foundations, we have two types. We have what we call industrial foundations. They own companies and they get a revenue from their companies. And then what we call general foundations, they normally live on, they have a money that they invest, and it's the interest of that that they then give back to society. But in Denmark, about the private foundation give out about 17 billion Danish kroner annually to back to society, you can say. And about half of that, more than half of that, is actually being given to research. And just to put the numbers in perspectives, the public research budget in Denmark, and this is 2017, was 21 billion kroner, and the private foundation's budget was 9 billion kroner, and about 8.4 billion of this went back to the universities. So about 30%, if you add these two numbers up, 30% of the total research budget in Denmark nowadays come from public foundations. So it's a dramatic change in the way research has been funded in Denmark if you just look over the last 10 years. So the situation is that if you look at how the private money has been spent on public research, they are distributed over all a priority on natural science, health science, and technical science. But just to keep the numbers in proportion, the 2% that is invested in humanity is in absolute numbers more than the public research invests in humanity, so because the numbers are so high. So what it means is that we in Denmark have a situation where we have public funding. If you look at the competitive lag on public funding in Denmark and kind of divide it into where on the different steps of research do we fund, we have two rather big foundations. We have heard about the Danish National Research Foundation that primarily invests in Center of Excellence, and then we have the Danish Foundation for Independent Research that you can say invest on individual persons. So this is mostly basic research. And then we have another innovation foundation that do our strategic research. Particularly, it bridges the gap between public research and private companies to the idea, of course, being to accelerate public research into applications. That you have then to compare to how much money now is coming from the private foundation that goes into public research. So in reality, you can argue that the agenda today in Denmark is set by the private foundations on how money is invested. And so on one way, it's a positive story. On the other hand, it also, of course, raises concerns about this balance. One thing that you should be aware of is also 80% of these private money, they came from only five foundations. The Novo Nordisk Foundation being the biggest one, of these five. And so I think we are in a fantastic situation on one hand, and on the other hand, we have an intensive dialogue in Denmark right now about how can we kind of secure and sustain a system that is having this balance. And therefore, there are been said, there are actually right now dialogues that where private foundation meet with public foundation together with the minister on a regular basis to discuss this. And I must say, overall, the ambition is, of course, this has to work. It's a success story. And how can we make sure that we optimize this to the benefit for Denmark? And just to dig a little bit deeper on and how the different big foundations are thinking, I would take the Lundbeck Foundation as the one that I am coming from, how we think, because I think it reflects the responsibility of many of the five major, or of all the five major founders, private founders in Denmark. First of all, we have a goal, and that is we have a broad interest in increasing talent in biomedical science. And this we really mean by the broadest mean. You don't really have to sit on a medical faculty to be supported from us, but you have to convince us it's for the benefit of biomedical science what you do. Secondly, we have a goal also to have an increased awareness of on neuroscience. And how do we combine these two goals? First of all, what we are saying is that we are going to spend most of our money on ideas driven by the researchers. We are not in the position, we believe, to set the agenda for what is the exciting new ideas tomorrow. Mm. We believe we are much better at identifying the very best people that can follow up on the great ideas they have. That's the one thing. The other thing is we're also saying, if this is going to work, we have to agree that each step on the career line here, there has to be money at each step. If you don't secure the pipeline, it will break, and therefore you will not get the full investment of what we are doing. So what we have actually for each of these steps, from postdocs up to fellows, and fellows is in this case where you get the independence. This is a 10 million kroner grant for 5 years. Then the idea is that you can start in principle here, and if you're good, you can go to fellows where you do your independence. You can move up to a more mid-career associate professor and continue and consolidate your research, and then you can move up to a full professor if you are very, very good. And for each of these three, you can only get funded once. Up here, we will keep funding you if you're good in principle. Of course, every 6 years, you have to come back and convince us you're good. So the idea is actually to notch the very bright young people within biomedical science at the broader sense and let them know if you are good, we have this path, and you should also be aware the more you climb up this ladder, the more of our money will be focused on neuroscience, but not again neuroscience defined in the broader sense, and the ideas has to come from you. The other leg we have is we do acknowledge that where this is all people-driven projects on a more PI level, there will be situations where it makes sense to bring people together. Particularly for a small country like Denmark, I think it's important to be able to set up collaboration where we attract top scientists from abroad with top scientists in Denmark. So one of the ideas of this collaborative projects are that if good scientists in Denmark can identify good collaborators in abroad, whether it makes sense to work together, we're going to fund the full package, even though that part of this is going to take place outside Denmark. Then the last thing we're doing is the experiment, and this is, you already been seen the thing about that in because it's not that different from what they do at the Folkvangstiftung, but I'll come back to that. But how do we then get the money to this? Because, I should also remember, yeah, we also have prizes. We have prizes where we like to acknowledge, of course, people that are doing outstanding research, and we have that at for the very young, for the more middle career, and for the exceptionally young people. We have the Brain Prize. This is a 1 million euro prize that we hand out every year to the best neuroscientists worldwide. And the money, where did it come from? This is our foundation. This is our founder. Grete Lundbeck founded the foundation in 1956. She was the widow after Hans Lundbeck. He was actually the one that established the company, H. Lundbeck. They didn't have any children. Therefore, she decided to put everything in the foundation. And today, the foundation have the majority shareholders in three big companies in Denmark, and it's the surplus from that investment and our own capital that then secure our investment in back into research. Last year we gave out about 600 million Danish kroner to public research, and what we have promised, and this is where we come back to this concern about what happens if all the companies have collapsed, not only for us, also for the Novo Nordic and all the other places. What would happen in Denmark if these private money suddenly went away? So the way we have done this is we have said we have our own capital about 14 billion kroner. So from these, we can secure that there is at least half a billion kroner every year present for Danish research, no matter what happens to our companies. And I know that the Novo Nordisk Foundation, they in principle have the same thinking. Even without the companies behind them, they have sufficient money, they can still keep injecting important funding into the Danish research community. And that goes for Carlsberg as well, it goes also for the Wilhelm Foundation, that are the other big players here. So that's the way where the private foundation are trying to send the signal. We are aware we are big, we are aware we have, we make a difference, but and we will not just suddenly disappear. Even though if our companies that make the income would disappear, we would still be there at least for sufficient time. Well, then coming back to, I mean, how we then give out our money. I think as we have heard this morning, the challenge is to identify the applicant that is most deserving. And I think we all agree the best mean we have to this today is peer review. And I think we can, there are various deviations of how we do the peer review. I think we all agree and can recognize that we have panel meetings, and in a typical panel meeting, a subset of the members, maybe 3 to 4, have written some application in details, and all have just maybe read the abstract, and then at the meeting, the one that has read most of the, have been dedicated the application will to the panel give their gradings and arguments for why they think this should be funded or not funded. And this is the way we do the discussion. We have already touched on pro and cons on this system, but I just want, and many of what, I think we all know there are issues here, but it's still the best we can do. But what I would like to do here is I would just like to dig down into some more recent analysis that I think was done in a very systematic and not only, as we have seen in the past, anecdotal way, and I think that would help us to understand some of the challenges we have. Pia and Al, last year actually, they did a very interesting study where they what they looked at was they explored how the panel at the NIH, the peer review process, assigned the ratings and also how consistent the reviewers were in evaluating the same applications. And now we're talking about applications that either will be funded in the first run or they will resupply and then reapply and then they will be funded later. So all the applications they saw were funded at some stages within 2 or 3 years by the NIH. So the first observation they have is that the reviewers do not reliably differentiate between good and excellent grant applications. So between this set of applications that initially were not all fundable, but later on they all were, you cannot as a reviewer actually tell which one is the very good and which one is the very best. There was a big variation in the judgment. So even the highest ranking proposals were actually not secure. This is actually consistent with a study done on NSF applications some years back, but not nearly as careful. And perhaps the most interesting part is that it also appears that the output of the grant review depended more on the reviewer whom the grant was assigned to than the research proposal itself. This is, of course, a very strong statement, but it was actually what Wilhelm also hinted to before. And this was actually done in a very careful way where they had applied a set of different statistics scores to look at this and without going into the details, but I would really recommend that you read this paper. So we have a challenge when we come to the situation where we all have fundable products in front of us to make the right decision. We can even go a step further and we can see what, if you start to look at ex ante and ex post analysis, then there is another interesting study here. This is again from NIH. What they have done is they have divided their application, the funded application, into 3 groups. The one that was highly graded initially, medium graded, and lower grade, but they were all funded. And then they looked at some classic methods of these three levels of funded projects. And what you can see is, on average, they produce the same number of output if you just count papers. And if you look at the citation, there was not that much of a difference either. This is, I think, per invested dollar here, yeah. And if you look at the citation per paper, so there was not much of a difference. So I think the whole main message here, even though there was quite a dramatic difference in the way they were originally judged, when it comes to the output 5 years later, we can't see that difference. This also actually goes from studies that I'm sure some of you are aware of from the ERC. What they also do, that's really good ex ante and ex post analysis. And what you see here is in one of the ex post analysis where they have done assessment of some of the ERC grants, they put them into four boxes: breakthrough research, excellent research, and not appreciable research. That's the last one. And this is the 401 out here. So this is the ex ante grading, and then you have the ex post, sorry, grading out here, and then you have the ex ante up here. And the message is actually the same as over here. You cannot predict between the excellent and the very good whom will perform better than the others when you come up to that set of high-level applications. And just as the last message to kind of underline this challenge we have is another study from the NIH. What you see here is what they look at how money is distributed between what they call high-standing institutions, this one, and more medium-ranged institutions, this is the red one. So what you see is that most money, the success rate is considerably higher for the high-standing universities, as is the money they get per university or per grant given. Again, if you then look at the output here, on these, you can argue rather simple methods. What turns out is that the output is more or less the reverse, that it is it's not the top universities that deliver the most impressive impact method on production and citations in invested money. So again, when we come to the situation where we have to take a choice between the very good applications, we have to take a decision, and that decision is very often tends to be biased in sometimes in a consistent way. So we have a challenge that we need to consider. For one thing, I think we all agree we need the peer review system, but we need to be much more open-minded about what the limitations is in the peer review system. And I think the argument has already been there, that what happens these days is that we will probably, because it's difficult for us when we have these low success rates, we will have a tendency to scientific conservatism and most likely also risk minimization in what we're doing, so thereby reducing diversity in the kind of different projects that we're going to fund. So one message here to bring with you home is, I think as foundations that give out money, we need to start to consider alternatives to how we give out money. We need to do experiments, as we saw with the Wilhelm Krull also hinted to before, on whom should we give the most deserving grants to. At Lundbeck Foundation, we have decided that we would actually spend 10% of our funding budget on trying to do experiments, and trying to go new ways in how we should fund the research. And one of the ways we want to go is actually based on my time when I was the director of the Danish National Research Foundation. We had every year annual visits to all the centers. This Lot and I, we spent I don't know how many times every year on the road to visit about 40 to 50 centers every year. And at every meeting, we spent about half an hour with the postdocs, and only the postdocs. And we addressed all sorts of issues with them. And what became very obvious in these discussions was that they were very much concerned about how to get funding for the ideas they burned the most for. They felt that they had to adapt their research proposal to what they think their peers would like to see. Certainly, they would not submit the ideas that they really liked the most if they didn't have anything that could kind of convince the peers that this could have a possibility, have a chance to succeed. So with those, I actually had a dialogue. I mean, how can we, what can we do to help you as a founder? And we talked, those one idea that came up was if they were anonymous, they would probably be, they would be more risk-taking in submitting what they were burning the most for, the ideas they would like to get funded. And one of their arguments were that at least then my peers would not laugh, they don't know whom they're laughing at. So I would have the courage to present what I like. Okay, I don't know what the chance is, but at least that was one step that was important for them. The other step was they had this concern that there was this conservatism in the peer review system, what I think is justified from some of the numbers I've given you. So what could we do about that? So again, of course, the idea was, one thing is that the peer reviewers didn't know whom submitted the application. That means it's a full focus on the idea and nothing else than the idea, as you heard about in the Folkvangstiftung experiment called. The other thing is, if these ideas really are kind of pushing the borderlines, are truly innovative, you cannot expect consensus from your peer review panel. So you need to design it in a way that the peer review panel do not need consensus on all the things that they assess if you want to look for the outlier. So what we did was very similar to what you heard about in the Folkvangstiftung experiment. We actually allowed every panel member to have what we call a decisive vote or a joker, meaning that if there was particular one application they felt was outstanding compared to the 50 or so applications they looked at, they should use the decisive vote. The condition was at that if they used that, we wanted a good reasoning for why they used it. So as the setup we have in this system is that you submit a very short application, it's anonymous. There is, we have a panel of 15 people. Then, in contrast to what you see in the Willem, the Folkvangstiftung, they don't meet here. But they are more or less asked the same task. The interesting thing is, when they do not meet, they all more or less all use the decisive vote. Mm-hmm. I think where I know they don't do that in the Folkvangstiftung, and one reason could be when you sit together with your colleagues, you're a little more careful in being risky. In this case, they nearly all use the votes, not always, but nearly all. And the interesting thing is, we also see in, I think, it's in one quarter or so that they use it on the same exciting ideas. So there is some consensus, but there's certainly also diversity in the way to do it. So, and then we do a very simple thing. All the decisive vote will be graded highest, and then the remaining applications that were, as in, maybe you do not give a decisive vote, this is a traditional grading system you use, and they will then follow, and then we will give products until there's no money left. So in this case, we have about 60 million kroner set aside to this. That means we can give 15 products on the decisive vote and 15 products on the more traditional one. And we're going to follow these two streams then for the next number of years to see if there's going to be any difference in the kind of projects we're going to fund in these two streams. And a similar setup is done by Willem Foundation in Denmark, where I initiated this. And again, we will have a strong dialogue with also the Folkvangstiftung and others that do stuff like this. You can go one more extreme, as there was hinted to in earlier also. You can also consider a situation if you have really high quality that where the success rate becomes very low. You can have a classical peer review system, and then in principle you can decide there whom are fundable according to your criteria. And what you do, you put them into a lot, and then you, by lottery, decide who should get funded. Instead of what you do today, you will have a more intensive discussion and probably through consensus agree on whom should get funded. I think one of the interesting things with this model is, one thing is probably, it becomes perhaps as a peer reviewer much more clear what you should discuss, but also for those that do not get funded, it makes more sense to get the story that you were good enough, you just lost the lottery this time. Try one more time, please. There are actually studies going on in New Zealand where they're trying this model, and we will see how it turns out. The problem whatever we do as a funder is, it takes 5 to 10 years before we know if this is a success or not. So you will have to be patient. But I would actually encourage all funders to reconsider at least to use part of the money on new ways to see how we identify great science. So thank you.
Thank you very much. A friend of mine is CEO of a company with, they do executive search and they evaluate a lot of candidates every day. And they have actually come up with a little robot. Have you seen it? The fur hat. So when you're a candidate to TNG, you actually meet an AI. And this is to avoid bias from the question. So that could be, I thought it might be an idea to use AI in the next generation. But apart from that, I know that you had a question for us at the end. So I will bring that to the panel. I'll leave the questions to you. It's much better. Any comments or questions? Anna?
Yes, I have one question about the NIH review of the review process.
Yeah.
The first conclusion that you presented on the slide was that it was impossible to in a reliable way distinguish between the good and the excellent proposals. How did they reach that conclusion? By an over reviewer, or in what way?
So what, if I remember right, is they have they have set up a shadow panel that so you ask a number. The shadow panel is repeating the original panel's decision on the exactly same applications. So the outcome on that was very different from the first one.
Yes, but how do you know that the final one's better than the first one?
I think the point is, it's not. That's not the point. The point is, that could also be the case.
Yes. Yeah. Okay.
The point is, it's not the same.
Okay.
But maybe just to follow up on that, I think we also all like to believe the more reviewers we have, the better. I just want to show you one slide here to be a little provocative on this part. This is also from the ERC. This is the bottom one here. Mm-hmm. What you see here is the number of reviewers, external reviewers applied on a given ERC application and the success rate for getting funded for the applications. Mm. It doesn't really matter. What is a little surprising. Mm. So sometimes we like to believe the more reviewers you have, the better it is. But these are the external reviewers that are used then by the panels at the ERC to take a final decision. So we have these internal things that sometimes we think it makes it more safe or more right, that it's not exactly what we see always, so, yeah.
Have we seen anything like this in the Swedish system? Anybody? Yeah, Göran and then, or Christina first, please.
Now, I had a slightly different question here about the Willow Foundation and the Jokers. If you can say something at all about the outcome, I know that this program is quite new. I have used 2 Jokers, so of course I'm very expecting to see the result, if they were good jokers or not.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we have to be patient. I mean, it will take 5 years before I think you really can start to say anything that makes sense. So one observation we had the first year, I think, was similar to the one they had at Folkfront, was actually that the females seems to be less successful than the males, but that didn't repeat on the second and the third round. So at least in our model, there is not a bias in the way that male and females write the applications, except for the first time we did it. But again, the numbers are small. We need to be careful with doing any conclusion at this time. So,
I think you're right that the number of reviewers is not, I mean, the thing that will solve it, because the thing that really scares me in fields where everyone agrees, doesn't matter if you have 2 or 100 reviewers, everyone agrees that it's good or bad. Mm. That's a bit scary. Mm. And then one has to construct something where you add in reviewers with different competences, different backgrounds. And then you have the applications where reviewers never agree. Mm. A typical example that we see quite often is when ecology meets cell biology or molecular biology. You can have 50 ecologists I think it's great. And then you get the molecular biologist along and I think it's crap. And these applications we found, I actually have the mandate to fund them. And I have no argument for fund them in addition to that. If they saw so many people disagree, it would be interesting to see what comes.
That's a good point, right.
If a lot of people disagree, there's a high risk and we must go in and investigate further. So please, thank you very much, Thomas Sinkjæer. It was very, very interesting.